So, let's begin. Deciphering 14 mysteries of Spirited Away. First, the mystery of the strange world. So, basically, well, my reference is the DVD. I mean, Ghibli's official Blu-ray. Now, when you play it, if you see the Totoro logo on the title scene at 0 minute 0 second, then the screen goes black. This stays for 3 seconds, then a flower and a card appear. There's a message on a card which says, "Take care, Chihiro. Let's meet again one day. Risa." And you see a girl who's looking at a card with a grumpy, well, not grumpy, but rather a motivated look and in a sloppy posture. Then we know she's the main character of the movie, Chihiro, and the movie is located in modern Japan. Chihiro Ogino, a 10-year-old girl in a car with her parents in the beginning of the movie, and they're moving to a new town. So you might wonder where this place is. But then you see a clue. It's Japan National Route 21 in Nakaoka. So, we don't know for sure if an area called Nakaoka really exists. Actually, this place is considered to be Kofu. If you take a left on Japan National Route 20, then you head towards Kofu. Right here, it says Tochinoki, which I guess is a new town. He turns right at this turning point. Then the title appears. Like this. It says Spirited Away, and the slope starts here in the picture at the bottom and goes all the way up. So that's the Audi that goes up the slope on the right and is still going up. He actually wants to go this way to the new town. It only takes a minute and 40 seconds at this point. A lot of detailed information is shown during this short period of time, so Spirited Away is actually quite fast-paced. On the other hand, nothing really happens during the first 40 minutes. So, after a minute and 53 seconds, the car enters the approach after passing by an old Japanese cedar tree and a Shinto gate that has fallen. From above here, the camera pans down. Now, do you see how the trunk of the cedar tree has broken? So have the branches and only a few leaves remain. When the camera pans all the way down, you see the paved road ends in the middle and turns into a mountain path. And that's where the gate leans right here on the tree. On the storyboard, there's an instruction that says, this gate needs to be broken and tilted. It must have once stood facing the pathway a long time ago. But someone must have taken it off and set it on the side. So, I must say whoever did it is quite sinful. I'm guessing that this area where the paved road turns into a mountain path was the starting point of the holy precinct, or the sacred area. And the giant cedar tree, which looks tremendously old and now dying, must be the symbol of the area. But the three people in the Audi enters the sacred land in a four-wheel drive mode without knowing anything. And here the father puts the car in neutral and wonders as he looks around going, "Oh, are we on the right direction?" Then Chihiro finds something mysterious. This is a cedar tree, and on the foot of the gate, you can see a lot of small houses made of rocks. These small houses are God's houses or small stone shrines, and I wonder if you can notice, but they have been thrown away, and it's not just one, but in a large number. And I want you to pay attention to how they are piled up in the disorderly way. I actually have the close-up picture of this. If you take a close look, you can clearly tell how these small shrines have been collected and thrown away altogether. I imagine that each of these has been placed in order along this approach back in the days and worshipped, but now they were removed and collected with the gate at the foot of the cedar tree. I imagine that one of the carpenters who did the construction work placed them together with the gate at the foot of the cedar tree that was once a sacred tree, so that they wouldn't be cursed. Well, although I think they are sinful enough to be cursed. If you look carefully as the car passes by, well, some of these stone shrines are missing roofs, and you can see how there are small tableware inside them. I believe they were used to offer things like sake, but do you see how one of them is in red? There's one that's in red, and I don't know, but it's somehow a bit creepy. This red is not subtle, but strikingly bright that jumps into your eyes. Now, you may have already noticed, but Spirited Away is actually a horror movie. It's basically a horror movie, but the second half is made with taste of fantasy, which is so fun to watch. It's hard for us to see it also because of the storyline where Chihiro changes her name to Sen and works. But at least for the first 30 minutes of the movie until the part where Chihiro meets Yubaba is pretty straightforward horror. So, how should we see this scene? Where an area that was supposed to be sacred is dishonored with the gate removed, God's house is abandoned, and a car with a four-wheel drive carelessly entering inside. Oh, I'm sorry, my tie's crooked. How about this? Well, I'm telling a scary story, so maybe that's why. So, the storyline and the depiction here are structured so similarly to a type of Hollywood movie where a family, without knowing, moves into a cursed land owned by Native Americans. As for Chihiro, she has just left her last school, but hasn't transferred to a new one. Belonging to nowhere means she's unsettled, like a god without a house. She can enter this mysterious and sacred world because she's put under the same circumstance as the gods who are unsettled as their stone shrines have been destroyed. There's a classic setting in horror movies, that is, you can't enter into a cursed area unless you share something in common with the curse. In this movie, the entire family is unsettled. They're in the middle of moving, plus, well, I'll explain this more next week, but they are in the middle of a family crisis. That's why the three of them somehow look fallen apart, but that's how they also qualify to enter this world. The family crisis part may be a bit hard to understand, so I will explain to you step by step next week. Anyway, that's how they end up entering the god's land by mistake. Okay, here. So, as the car runs through the mountain, the path suddenly turns into a stone pavement. It turns into a stone pavement and the car shakes and rattles. I mean, this is a mountain path. And the fact the path becomes a stone pavement means that it is important enough for people in the past to lay the pavement. It's in the middle of a mountain, and the stone pavement is so much older than the, say, Edo period, so that indicates how sacred this path is. Even castles rarely lay stone pavement around them, so having one is a sign that they are entering into such sacred land. But the father doesn't notice it and drives the car in a furious speed. On the storyboard, there's a comment that says the mom is used to the dad's reckless driving. That's why she doesn't change her facial expression. But for Chihiro, it was the first time to see her dad drive like that, so she's so surprised. And suddenly, a tunnel shows up in front of them. And in front of the tunnel, there's something called Sekijin, which is like a doll in a shape of a human. Those stone figures are typically excavated from ancient Japanese tombs in the northern part of Kyushu Prefecture. And you can tell that this sacred area has been developed quite a long time ago. So when the family wonders what this is and looks up above this red tunnel, you see unreadable letters. And there's some sort of a roof and a sign over here, but you can't read what it says. Although it actually says Aburaya, there's an instruction on the storyboard that says make them unreadable. So what continues from here is a theme park with a hot spring facility that's built before the economic bubble burst. But there's no real hot spring. I mean, because there's no spring source. Aburaya in the movie boils regular water with a charcoal kiln instead of natural hot spring. So it's a fake spa, but they still claim that it's hot spring village. I'll explain this more in details as they get to the town. But the car suddenly stops around 3 minutes past since keep changing fast. It's only been 3 minutes 23 seconds since the Totoro logo and the title. So the parents enter the tunnel, the father seems unalerted and says, "Oh, it's just made of mortar, this building is pretty new." He talks like he knows what this place really is, but that's because he works in an architecture industry, that's how he knows so much about the architecture. So he doesn't care, but a strong wind blows from behind them and they blow together and enter into the tunnel. That gives Chihiro a bad feeling, so she refuses strongly to go inside the building. This is at 4 minutes 18 seconds. She says, "I'm not going." Only the father and the mother go in. But when Chihiro glances at the stone figure, it's actually kind of hard to tell, but the camera zooms into the stone figure extremely slowly. You may notice it more easily if you look at the edge. The lens is closer to the subject in this picture compared to this one. The background flows outward. It's so subtle, but the scene is so carefully depicted with such a slow tracking shot where the camera gets closer to the figure. Chihiro's mind is captivated by it, and she's having a bad feeling. This is only a 2-second cut, so you can't really tell what's going on. By the way, there was originally a setting that this stone figure turns into a frog at night and spouts water from its mouth. But later they omitted the setting thinking that they would be going too far. But there is a scene where another stone figure spouts water from its mouth. So, please think the reason why there is a river between the two worlds which prevents Chihiro to cross is because this guy eventually turns into a frog. So, that's how they enter the building. Chihiro has a bad feeling, but still she ends up going inside. This is a scene where the father and the mother go inside a tunnel for the first time. The mortar wall is painted in red. This is a scene at the end. This is almost at the last scene. The family is coming back from the other world. Here, you see the same tunnel, but the stone figure has turned into a mere boulder, and the wall is a stone wall that is covered by trees. They aren't exactly the same tunnels in the beginning and at the end. So before they enter the tunnel, they're already being tricked. They have already entered the other world. So the mysterious world doesn't start when they come out of the tunnel, but before they enter it. Then when exactly do they cross the boundary line? Well, it's probably right when they pass by the small stone shrines that they enter the world of gods. So, this is 5 minutes and 53 seconds. When they reach the end of the tunnel, they see a wide plain and an uphill stretching out, which later becomes like an ocean. And there's no one on that plain. This is 6 minutes and 50 seconds. As Chihiro gets worried and says, "Mom, Mom, I don't want to go, I don't want to go." The mother just says, hurry up, Chihiro, but not even wants to look at Chihiro in the eyes. The father and the mother are actually in a good mood. When the mom loses her balance, the dad catches her saying, are you okay? And smile at each other, but they only tell Chihiro to hurry up. This is strange. There's a reason why both parents and especially the mother is acting cold to Chihiro, but I will talk more about this next week on the second half. And I'm gonna go in depth on this. It's been said that parents are childlike, like young couples, so they leave Chihiro out, but there's no way, Miyazaki does something so meaningless. I'll talk more about this next week. So, after they leave the tunnel at 7 minutes and 38 seconds, they see a very strange scene spread out. They get to this point in 7 minutes and 38 seconds. It's even faster than some Hollywood movies. So, you see these creepy billboards in the shape of an eye, which remind me of the manga of Yoshiharu Tsuge. Then as the camera pans down, you see the father and the mother and Chiharu, Chisato, no, it's Chihiro. So Chihiro follows up the stairs. I really can't get the name right. So this unmanned entertainment district spreads out. And this area is in between the real world and the illusionary world. So, humans built a bunch of weird buildings to create a theme park in originally sacred area where gods lived, with the money that they earned just before the bursting of the bubble economy. That's how the monsters ended up inhabiting there. Well, Chihiro's father says these are the remains of the bubble economy, but actually, this kind of theme park was everywhere in Japan since Meiji period. So, for example, there used to be an observatory in Asakusa, Tokyo called Fujisan Soranjo. This is the brochure from the back then. They made a miniature of Mount Fuji in Asakusa Roku Entertainment District in Meiji 20th. It was 32 meters tall, so it was pretty tall. And not only that, people could climb it up to the top. There's a picture too. We only have one with low quality. You can see people riding bikes in the front, so you can compare the heights. But this is what was called Asakusa Fuji. Again, it's 32 meters tall, so it was pretty tall to the point that people could actually walk the path from the bottom to the top. However, it was destroyed in Meiji 23rd, and the famous Ryōunkaku, or so-called Asakusa 12 stories, was built on that site. Well, it looked like a vertical version of Leaning Tower of Pisa, so this kind of buildings were built in Asakusa. There's even a color print of this. Many buildings like this were built in Asakusa, and they were in great numbers during the good times in Meiji and Taisho period. There were many famous leisure facilities like Keiokaku Yuen, Kagetsu Yuenchi, and Togetsu En. There was also a garden called Okuyama Fuke in Asakusa, which was called a department store of shrines and temples with all kinds of Shinto gods and Buddha available to worship. These kinds of places appear in novels written by Rampo Edogawa, such as Strange Tale of Panorama Island and Ghost Tower. Rampo wrote different novels with similar plots where people build theme parks during an economic bubble between the end of Meiji period to Taisho period that insult gods, or should I say, ignore their sanctitude, which triggers a series of mysterious incidents. Well, if any of you want to know more about this, I'll talk a bit more as I show some reference. Well, what I want to point out here is that Spirited Away is set in an abandoned theme park where ghosts settle in. So there are some similarities. So at 9 minutes, Chisato's parents Chihiro's parents, I keep saying her name wrong. While her parents eat the food feverishly, Chihiro has a bad feeling, so she leaves the parents and walks around the town. So, it's this scene. She's walking the town. An empty downtown extends endlessly. There are lanterns that are later lit up beautifully. What I like here is that composition where Chihiro stands at the corner of the screen. Also, pay attention to where the shadow is. There are the buildings that are right above, or they tilt slightly as the sunlight shines in. These details foreshadow the scary events that happens later, so every detail has a meaning. Chihiro is put on the opposite side of the shadow intentionally to say that it's still bright outside and nothing has happened yet, but something will happen soon. And in fact, the story does get scarier and scarier from here and on. As she climbs up the stairs, she sees a mysterious building. There's a gorgeous pine tree and a garden lanterns, and beyond them, an arched bridge with red handrails. And beyond that arched bridge is a gigantic bathhouse named Aburaya. Well, the red arched bridge is built for a practical reason as well, but it's made to follow a rule of Chinese thoughts of Shengxian, where any place mountain wizards live has an arched bridge for visitors to cross so they can enter a different world. The rich people back in old days in Japan built Japanese gardens, but despite the names, they were supposed to be sacred lands of gods where Chinese mountains wizards would live. That's how each of those gardens had a miniature version of arched bridges. So this one in the picture is a huge version of it. And beyond that, you see some magnificent structure. At 11 minutes and 15 seconds, Chihiro tries to cross the bridge, but she's not supposed to because across the bridge is God's land. But regardless, she tries to go to the other side. Then a boy named Haku, dressed in white, appears and says, "Go back! You can't go any farther." So, this is Haku. He says, "Go back, you can't go," facing and approaching the screen. But then, as you see, the shadow behind Haku extends drastically. So, because the sun is set in rapid speed, the shadow of the bridge behind him grows so vigorously while Haku talks in a hurry, and his profile becomes more and more red. The red sky is spreading out and the shadow grows horizontally longer and longer. This is what you see in a vampire movie. The scenes is so horrific. The scene also shows how fast time passes in the world Aburaya exists in, which is the world of gods and wizards. As you can see from here, it's 10 times faster than the real world. Later, I will explain why 10 times faster, but the whole plot of Spirit Away only takes about 4 days. It's only 3 nights and 4 days in length, but it's about a month long in the real world. Actually, maybe even longer than that. And how fast the time flows in a different world is an important theme, which I will explain next week, so please keep that in mind. For now, let's just remember that the time goes really fast there. Then the lanterns are lit up and black shadows grow out of the ground on the street that was previously unmanned. And Chihiro panics and tries to run back to the parents saying, "Dad, Mom!" Then the parents have unnoticeably turned into pigs as a punishment for eating the offering for the gods. On top of that, these numerous black beings that look like ghosts appear in the town that has already darkened. These are so well depicted. the previously empty town is now filled with these black shadows that have silently grown from the ground, and they start wandering around Chihiro. As she decides to leave the parents and runs down the stairs to where she originally came from, she sees more black shadows approaching her. So, the taste of the movie becomes more and more like a horror movie. However, when she descends the stairs, she notices that the white plain has turned into water. The tunnel which she has walked through is now far away, and there are city lights beyond the tunnel. Between them is a large body of water, like an ocean. Now she can't return home. This scene shows hopelessness, but it's also beautiful. It also shows how Miyazaki doesn't just explain things, but rather show them visually. Chihiro says, "It's all I, disappear, disappear." Then her body starts becoming translucent. Then a tremendously gorgeous and luxurious fairy appears. And from that fairy, a lot of strange monsters come ashore. But Chihiro also sees them through her translucent hands. The scene depicts two different situations. One is that Chihiro is in fear as she realizes her body is vanishing. The other is that through those hands, she finds the glimmering fairy. The two circumstances of what is happening to her and around her are being visualized simultaneously in one frame, so I can't say how well the scene is shot. It's not explanatory, but more suspenseful, which makes the viewers curious to see what will happen next. The storyboarding in this scene is a true masterwork. Now, when the fairy arrives at the shore, gods come out. Now, it's a characteristic of Japanese gods that they are invisible. They don't possess appearances. I think I've explained this before, but let's take an example of Namahage in Akita Prefecture. People cover their virtual gods with masks and straw capes to pretend that's how they look like, knowing that essentially gods are shapeless. This idea is close to the worshipping of spirits in Southeast Asia. That's why the English title of this movie is Spirited Away. It means that these beings that you see in the movie are closer to spirits and gods. You can't see their bodies, so the only things you can see are the masks that they wear. However, those spirits in the movie become more and more substantial and visible to Chihiro as they come ashore, even though they aren't supposed to be. So this world is in a realm that is between the real world where the humans live and the world of gods. So the monsters come ashore one after another, but Chihiro at this point just think of them as monsters, not gods. Chihiro freezes in fear. Then Haku, that handsome boy, arrives and lets her eat food from this world. She needs to eat something that belongs to this world or she disappears. When she eats it, her body finally goes back to normal. After that, Haku takes Chihiro to the side of Aburaya and tells her that she needs to go see Kamaji, who is in the boiler room, and ask him for a job. Because whoever doesn't work here is turned into an animal by Yubaba, a witch who rules Aburaya. It's only 60 minutes up to this point. They're so dense and made with aesthetics of horror movies. But Miyazaki made it just slightly less scary so the kids could watch. All the necessary essences are still there, though. For example, the parents do what they mustn't do without listening to Chihiro's warnings. Chihiro enters a place even though she senses danger. And like in vampire movies, the day turns into the night in a furious speed as the sun that was so bright up in the sky suddenly sets. Then these strange beings appear on the dark street. These amazing scenes unfold one after another without an interval in such short time. This is really the best horror movie sequence in the world. But not many people see this movie as a horror movie. So, one of the 14 mysteries that we covered tonight is about a mystery of this mysterious world. So, what is this world? It's one of the theme parks built by arrogant humans on ancient sacred places during the period of bubble economy. On top of that, this theme park was destroyed and the entire facility was turned into a haunted house. So that's what this mysterious world is. The situation resembles the one in Shining. It's like their haunted house made so much bigger in scale. That's why people don't realize that it's a horror movie. They think that it's a fantasy. What really makes the intro of this movie so entertaining is that it's got the taste of a horror movie like Shining with scary scenes and a haunted house, but it's hard to tell because the audience starts sympathizing with the ghost as the story proceeds and the protagonist starts working with them. So the main plot is about a girl who gets stuck in the world and can't get out. The parents turn into pigs and her body starts vanishing as well, so the movie starts as a great horror movie, then it starts shifting towards a fantasy movie. This movie actually got the concept of shifting from a horror to a fantasy from somewhere else. Where did that come from? Well, I'll talk about it in the next segment.